by TY. Really solid, safe play from the Korean Terran.
Dominating fashion.
Yeah.
Sad to see.
Tragic, really.
Tragic story at the end there. But luckily, he lives to fight at another tournament on another day.
Benjamin, thoughts on closing thoughts on that series?
Are you guys having some, like, stare contests, like just not stopping and looking at
one
another?
I don't know what you're on about, Ben.
I don't know what you're talking about.
But anyway, to be serious, unlike you over here, Nathan, TY played really, really good. I actually am starting to feel slightly left out of this.
Why? We're all talking together as a group.
We're just having a conversation, Benjamin. I don't know what you're talking about. We're just having some fun here.
You're right,
your eyes have started watering. But yeah, TY played awesome, man. Like, he was very defensive. He knew exactly what Puck was doing, it seemed. Even when Puck had the build on Orbital Shipyard where he just blinked into the main, TY dealt with it really well, despite losing one full medevac instantly. His build just seems very finely tuned to deal with middle-of-the-road builds. Like, it wasn't tuned to deal with Lilbo shameless I'm-going-to-kill-you builds, but everything else, he seems pretty well adjusted.
Yeah, definitely great to see. The next series that we're going to have is Showtime versus Bly. Bly earlier talked about how he felt confident because he's already beaten Showtime. Showtime did have a couple of cheeky games that come back on Prion Terraces in his previous PVZ. Like, he's shown he can, you know, he can survive in craziness in the current matchups.
As much as Bly said that he learned from the series that, you know, he lost a map against Showtime in, the same goes the other way, too. Showtime would have learned a lot, and I think we've already seen bits and pieces of that coming from day one to day two. He looked, you know, as I think it's safe to say, the best Protoss player up there with Parting in that tournament area. When we saw him play, it was so good, so solid. And I think Bly, as much as he's confident, I don't think it's going to be as easy as he's predicting it to be.
Yeah. Do you guys have any particular things that you noticed that really jumped out to you and you think, you know, how Showtime played a series earlier today? Is Bly, does he have to approach Bly like he's completely different than everybody else? Because we know that Bly is good with the aggressive play, but I feel like he can still play out the long game if he has to.
You have to be cautious when you play Bly. He has weird builds, and you know he's going to be aggressive. It's not a case of, oh, is Bly going to play a macro game? No, he's going to try and do something a little bit sneaky, so you have to be careful. But you also have to take into account, I think, Bly's control here, given that he is so confident, nerves aren't working so against him. So will you be able to get off these, like, big bulky disruptor balls, Desro balls, you know? They're not going to be able to hit so many units as they were against the laser and grabbing grabbing Showtime back into the game.
Yeah, I'm not so sure, though. I mean, we can see how much this means for Bly right now. We can see it in his reaction after he defeated Lambo, and I'm not sure if he's not going to be nervous here.
But in a
he has a lot of online experience, but I'm not sure now that he's this far in the tournament and going up against Showtime after watching how Showtime played. I think if I was Bly, I would be starting to feel a little bit nervous right now.
Potentially, but one of the most micro-intense matchups, which is ZVZ, his micro didn't really falter at all.
That is true, but he also used very simple, straightforward builds. And
it was one of the fastest series we've seen. If
yeah,
not 15-minute
four-game series.
We didn't get to see those grand-scale fights that we saw from Showtime. And if Showtime manages to make the game drag on longer, then Bly also has to succeed at, like, the multitasking and the truly big battles.
I think that's
we
a really
didn't see that yet in the
that's
CVC.
A fair point.
And Showtime has very good LAN experience too, with, like, so many EPS games going on.
Yeah,
two-time
EPS champion.
I really feel that the longer the game, as simple as it sounds, the longer the game goes, the more and more favored Showtime will become.
Yeah, I think that's
strange.
It's weird because most people talk about Zerg having all those late game tools, but PVZ's been pretty good. We're about to find out who's actually going to win this match, guys. The next series is ready. Have fun, guys. It's Showtime versus Bly.
Thank you very much, Nathanius. We are excited for this. We talked about it off stream. We're going to talk about it on stream as well. Do you think Bly can break this bulletproof vest that Showtime's ultimately going to have to wear?
Quite possibly. I mean, if there's one guy that likes to come up with these crazy, crazy builds,
it's going to be Bly.
It's going to be Bly.
Do you believe in hashtag Bly on fire? Are you a believer?
Well, as the resident fire extinguisher, I'm not so sure.
All right, well, we're almost ready for what I've told. The game is just loading. This is, of course, a battle to decide who can get top six here at the DreamHack Winter Legacy of the Void Rocket Championship. We've seen, unfortunately, our first player get eliminated at this stage. It was just Puck, who went down 0-3. And now it's time to lose another player. And this will be the last player that is eliminated from the tournament today. The next games, we're going to be going up to the winner bracket, where no one is eliminated, but advance further in the tournament and come down to face the winner of this next series. And here we are into game numero un. It is down here in the bottom left-hand side. Sporting in is the red Terran player from Germany. It is showtime.
Very, very strong Protoss play from him so far. Solid win rates. We know that those aren't exactly accurate, but overall on ladder has been doing very well. And here in the top right, playing Zerg from Team Acer, is Bly.
Bly's on fire.
Hashtag Bly on fire.
Hashtag Bly on fire. His biggest result since 2012 at DreamHack Bucharest, where he got to the final on loss versus his teammate. Still, even at this time.
Very early probe scout here. Actually blocks Bly's attempt at taking this base. Already a very, very nice start for Showtime, and Bly has to take the in-base natural. Even if he would like to take this one, Showtime might put down a pylon, but I don't really think so. Not enough minerals.
Nexus first for Showtime. And then Gateway behind it. We saw this every single game a little bit earlier on when Showtime played. They had different variations, whether it would be the double Stargate approach, three Gateway Adepts off the back of this, and then into the robotics facility, which is in the last game, where he went for his Disruptor.
Yep, a very, very safe map to do the Nexus first on. It's very easy to wall off. In general, just a very safe map for Showtime. So I like this approach, just going for the greedy Nexus first opening.
Yep.
Bly looking to take the third hatchery. There it goes down on the low ground here on Orbital Shipyard.
And is spotted by the German instantly. He knows.
And there's the double gates again. The bread and butter of this tournament so far.
He's moving out. Is this just the cyber core? It looks like it is just going to be the cybernetics core for this probe.
Yep. And no gas for Bly just yet. He's not choosing the same approach as Elise.
So would you like Stalkers to be used against a non-gas player? Or would it be okay just with the Adepts, which he usually goes for?
I wouldn't really mind some parting proxy pylon action here.
Oh, yeah, baby. It's a good map to do so.
I think Orbital is a nice map, especially since he forced Bly to take the in-base natural. It means that the creep spread on the third base most likely will be quite delayed. So he could actually put the pylons below the ramp and use that in a very obnoxious and annoying way.
Are we going to see that kind of...
It's a combination.
It's a combination. It's a bit of both, Snoot. It's an Adept and a Stalker coming out here.
Interesting.
So unfortunately, that Overlord is just going to move back. It's not going to be an easy snipe. That's going to just retreat and look for a scout a little bit later on once we get to the time where the first tech structure or third base will be put down in a quick scout. Coming in from Bly.
And Bly is going to get the read on this, forcing a pylon in the wall off. Showtime doesn't want to let Bly inside his own base.
I can't believe this probe stayed alive there, actually. Well, he does get taken out eventually, but for the cost of four Zerglings if he chases. He's playing safe, though.
It's very nice here for Showtime to prevent Bly from scouting, even if it means that, you know, Showtime is usually not the guy to do something crazy, but still, it's nice to keep Bly guessing.
And I think what's really solid, well, not so much solid, but really good to see from Showtime, he's changed it up every single game, including the last series to this series too. And it's the first time we've seen him go straight for a Twilight Council here, which obviously Bly would love to get his eyes on, but he has not yet. Where would he branch from this? Dark Templar, straight over towards Blink for a crazy build.
So far, Robo actually, War Prism comes to mind here. I was about to say it could be one of those very, very quick War Prism attacks, and there we have it. We actually have the Adept upgrade, so it could be one of those anti-circling builds coming up here.
So this is increases the attack speed of the Adepts. More dangerous unit it shall become.
Could it also just be an expansion? I don't think so. This feels very aggressive from Showtime, but at the same time, he's making two probes at a time, and Bly is just responding very, very well to this. Just making drones. No unnecessary tech, no circling speed, no Roach Warren for safety. Just keeping it very simple right now, and I like that a lot from Bly. He shows that he can do more than just be aggressive. Really powering hard here on the economy.
Well, it's a total of four gateways before the third Nexus has been thrown down here for Showtime.
Also getting the safety spore, I like that a lot. He saw a very limited amount of gas units. Doesn't know, doesn't have the information.
Yeah.
Showtime has been opening with the Stalker, but only using it to prevent Bly from scouting, so I like these safety spores a lot here. It could be DTs, so very good solid play for Bly here, even if it's not going to pay off in this game.
Oh, all the extractors are being taken now as well as a fourth base. on the way now for Bly. Roach Warren now started. Still not exactly sure what he's playing against, but a very generic, general, overall setup where he can cover the majority of strategies from Protoss being thrown at him. And an additional two gateways, so we're going up to a total of six now for Showtime, who starts a couple of upgrades, the plus one attack and the blink, while moving out for the first time to get a bit of damage done himself with the Warp Prism.
Overseer gets taken down as it scouts the Forge. The Forge means Showtime most likely going for that long-term play that we saw earlier from him this tournament. This Warp Prism might be able to get a little bit done, but there is
no
real drones here.
Really yet. Look at this. There's only 14 army supply, and I think it's a handful of Zerglings, and that's it. Pure drones, double evolution chamber, Lurkaden coming in. This Warp Prism has not been spotted here, Snoot.
Yeah, but on the flip side, Showtime has invested so much into the infrastructure, and I don't believe that he really has the aggressive potential available to him right now. It's going to take a little while before that economy kicks in. Still yet to make more probes, though. It could be that he's actually going to be aggressive eventually here.
Four Adepts get into the mineral line, trying to do as much damage as possible. Eight Hydras was started as the Warp Prism came in, or just before it came in.
And Bly is making nine more drones, and Showtime isn't making any probes at all. I think Bly is about to fall into a trap here.
And the army, as you can see on the minimap from Showtime, has already moved out into the middle of the map. He's picked off 10 workers, forcing a reaction of re-droning while striking at the same time. The German attacks the fourth base, and it's looking to instantly get rid of this, and hopefully more so, pick up map number one. He's got an observer to clear creep, continues to warp in. Do we have enough of a defensive army for Bly?
Notice how this hits right before the Lurker Den is complete. This is a pre-Lurker timing designed to kill the fourth base, cancel it, and also cause a little bit of trouble in the third. And notice how Showtime, he's not all in. It's only six gateways. It's not eight, yeah. It's not 10. And he's making probes behind this like we know that Showtime likes to do. It's a very soft attack, but still very powerful at the same time.
A lot of Hydralis here, starting to do quite a bit of damage, but Showtime's not scared. He's taking the fight against
these units.
I'm
not sure if he should be extending this far. Like I said, this is not... It's not as powerful as an attack as it could have been, but it's still succeeding with it.
He's taking down a lot of drones here. 26 in total, another aggressive warp in. I mean, ultimately, goal would be to take down the hatch, but he continues to strike forward. The lurkers are on the way. He moves forward aggressively, taking down more drones at this point, and there is hardly any units left for Bly.
Wow, Bly just made a few too many workers here, not being ready to deal with his timing. Those extra additional eight drones, they really hurt him here. There's even an observer, so he has no problem dealing with the lurkers now that they finally are out. And everything is just lining up so well for Showtime here, as he's completely wrecking everything in Bly's third base.
What a perfect strike, a perfect time to hit by Showtime.
Great killer instinct as well, noticing that Bly, in fact, overdrones. Bly could have held this if he didn't overdrone, but the initial harassment from Showtime caused Bly to overdrone. He thought, all right, this is just a war prison with a few adepts in it. But
no.
Multiple stalkers moved out on the map towards Bly's fourth base, and Bly was not ready for it.
And Showtime continues an undefeated day here at DreamHack Winter. 3-0 against the Laser, and now moves forward 1-0 against Bly. And that is a fantastic continuation of dominance against Zerg players. And he's using a variety of strategies every single game, changing it up, and it's great play to see.
It's really amazing. He shows how versatile he is as a player, and at the same time, he shows his understandings of the timing attacks. He also has the killer instinct.
Yeah.
A lesser player might have been a little scared to keep pushing forward into that third, and usually, in some cases, maybe the Zerg would have a few more units, but he really noticed that Bly was lacking in units, and then they just went for it. And, Showtime is scary, man. Like, what can we say?
He's a good player. He's even giving
very
you chills
player.
On the side of the desk, watching from this side.
Showing some very, very strong games here.
Indeed, and hopefully he can continue like this, because he's becoming a real threat to the championship, and of course to the Koreans still left in this tournament as they look upon seeing Showtime's dominance. More of them will be playing a little bit later on, but Showtime looking to move to day three. And will he be able to, as we already have two non-Koreans made it to day three just by succeeding into the winner bracket from winning group stages, but will he be able to join them in the fight for the championship of the very first Premier Legacy of the Void tournament? But thinking from Bly's side of things now, you've gone into this fully confident in yourself, in your matchup. You've just gone in and you've been hit pretty hard by this attack. Maybe, as you said, there might have been nerves starting to creep in a little bit pre-game, maybe sinking in a little bit more now. You've known Bly for many years now, 5 years in total, pretty much in StarCraft II. What do you think? Could you imagine him going through?
I feel like he played a very, very good game, pretty much from start to finish until that point where he made those extra drones. And if I was experiencing this as Bly, I would think this was just a very small mistake. And if I keep it a little bit more simple and maybe up my scouting just a tiny bit more, Bly also tried to scout a lot and did a very good job of it. So I would only consider this a minor mistake, but against a player like Showtime, just a minor mistake can be enough. Bly just needs to make some small adjustments to his macro play, and then I think this would have been a completely different game.
All right. Thank you very much, Snoop. And I hope you can continue to give your expert analysis, and I don't hope, because I know you will. Down here to the south side of Prion Terraces, our wonderful gold base map, it is Showtime.
Showtime having to play on Bly's map choice this time.
Oh, yeah. He won it when a laser picked it. Can he win it here up here? To the top side, it is, of course, Aces Bly from the Ukraine. He's got the hover hand, the keyboard hover hand Bly has. And Showtime, too, actually. It's a battle of the hover hands.
The proper posture players.
The thumbs up from Dr. Dario saying it is fully acceptable for your wrist.
I hope so. Let's make a phone call.
double gateway now starting up from Showtime before the cybernetics call. So we are going to see a bit of a rush of units to begin this game with. And double gas as well. And a different build again. Five maps in a row now versus Zerg and a different build again.
Showtime is so scary. He truly prepared well for this tournament. So many builds, so many different openings, and now even showing one base play after staying on two base openings for such a long time.
And he puts the pile on in a position which Bly's got a little bit lucky with and has his overlord spot in it very early.
That's not luck. This is actually very good scouting because this is a very normal proxy location, and I don't really like this pylon positioning from Showtime. Okay. It's a very, very common place for Zerg to search. I actually like the right-hand side a little bit more, but there you have the watchtower. It really depends on what he's going to put down, though. This is a one-base build, and adepts are on the way. But Bly is already responding. He's making a gas, making Zerglings. He is making a second hatchery, and I'm not sure if that's what he wants against Showtime is doing.
These Zerglings, where are they going? Are they going to take down the pylon? Are they just going to... They're going to go to the other side of the map, run into the Adepts.
Yeah, I don't think this is the right call from Bly, because at home, there's going to be a Mothership core. This is not, back in Heart of the Swarm, this would be very delayed.
Oh, he's turned around now with the Zerglings.
Yeah, a little bit of indecision. But as he sees these Adepts, he knows that he's not going to be able to cause any problems at home of Showtime's base, because there's a wall up there. These Zerglings can't do anything, but here, they can take down the pylon. And they should be able to, but if they had more time, they might have been able to find this probe and actually kill it. And I feel like, well, we'll see though. Maybe Bly's getting us surrounded on these Adepts. No, chooses to go for the pylons instead. I don't think it's possible to stop the gateways at this point. They're complete.
Oh, he's chasing this down. A Spinecrawler started here for Bly as well as a Roach Warren. Warp Gate not done yet. But these two Adepts
very
running circles around these Zerglings.
Great micro from Showtime, not losing a single Adept there, only losing shield damage as well. Bly investing into Spinecrawlers also, that's going to be great against Adepts, but Showtime doesn't have to make Adepts at all. He can also switch into Zealots and Stalkers, which are far better against the Spinecrawler.
This is looking really good for Showtime, to be honest. This is looking great. He's got a lot of units on the way now, total of four gateways.
I do like that Bly cancelled the natural hold. That was a very good call, and if he had kept it, I'm sure this would be a very difficult hold. Bly, however, didn't even get to transfer many drones from the main, so his income, this gold base, is not really being put to use as much as he would like.
Oh, there's five roaches here and a queen. Quite a lot of adepts still around. They're going to move towards the natural. Here comes around the Stalkers, and he's off group, as you say, and he's going to take a lot of damage to these roaches. Already down to less than half hit points.
Two roaches
instantly. And a third one's going to get picked off, and Showtime. Great start here. 14 Zerglings are on the way, but another round of units is going to be popping out shortly. A roach gets caught in between the bases here as well.
And in order to get these roaches out, Bly actually sacrificed Zergling speed. So there is no Zergling speed. And even then, Lings are not good against Adepts. This is just a very, very brutal build from Showtime. He can exploit the distance between the main and the gold base using the Adepts. Obviously, for Bly to deal with this, he has to be mobile, but the only mobile units for Zerg at this stage in the game are Zerglings, and they're horrible against Adepts.
I can't believe how well Showtime is playing here. Game after game, build after build, strategy after strategy. He comes up with something else and is completely caught Bly off guard with this. He was not ready for this. He probably has never even played against something like this before. But here we have Showtime moving forward with an army that looks absolutely unstoppable at this point. He goes forward and this is going to be an easy pickup of a 2-0 to start this best of five series. And as comfortable and as confident Bly was looking, things are crumbling before his eyes.
Yeah, definitely not going for that pylon early on and being so indecisive with those initial six circlings really hurt Bly there. Could have easily stopped those gateways from going down simply by sniping the proxy pylon, but it never happened. And Showtime goes up 2-0.
Showtime is setting the rules here at the Rocket Legacy of the Void Championship at DreamHack Winter in Jönköping. Nate always loves my pronunciation of that. I do try my best. I'm not the best of languages. How do you say it? You can give us a twirl.
Well, I'm not Swedish. I'm Norwegian, but I can try.
Yep.
Jönköping.
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 Jönköping. So thank you very much there, Snoop, for the assistance.
I tried. It was an honest attempt.
We talked about Swedish and Norwegian a little bit before, and you said it's very similar to like a German and Dutch comparison, where it's different, but it's similar.
Yeah, a lot of it is similar, but there's a lot of small differences here and there. So if you want to speak it fluently, there's quite a lot to learn. But for the most part, if you read it written, then it's usually very easy to understand.
If a Swedish person came up to you and asked you for directions or, hello, I'm looking to go over here, do you know how to get there in all Swedish, you'd be perfectly able to understand.
Yeah, I believe so.
Wow. That's awesome, man. I'm not a very good person with languages, to be honest. I'm very similar to an American, I suppose.
Denmark, however, when it comes to the
Danish,
Nordic, yeah.
Bit harder
to understand.
Well,
When spoken. There's always the potato joke and everything.
The potato joke? There's a joke around potatoes?
Yeah, that when Danes speak, it sounds like Norwegian in a sense, but that they talk with a potato in the mouth, so it's like...
Is this what you say to Danish people as a Norwegian,
it's a
vice versa
thing? It's just a Scandinavian rivalries here and there, and funny jokes and all that stupid, all those stupid things.
I don't. Anyway. We don't really have many. I guess we take the Mickey out of the way Americans speak as an Englishman, but we don't really have that many rivals when it comes to English. But we are almost ready for map number three, and you got the maps in front of you.
Let's see here. The third map is going to be Seras, and that's once again Showtime's choice. A big macro map, four-player map.
Yeah.
And could see anything, honestly. Showtime is showing us so many different builds. I don't think he's going to go for something like a one-base cheese this time around.
No.
But maybe some Phoenix play.
Phoenix play? Sounds good. I'd love to see some Phoenix play. We're about to find out as map number three has loaded, as Showtime is the German wrecking ball down here in the bottom right-hand side. Spawning in is the red Protoss.
Look at this.
Look at what?
There's an extractor here in the base of the Zerg player in the top left, Acer Bly. Putting down the spawning pool as we speak.
Desperate situations call for desperate measures, Snoot. He's down 0-2, and he's gone directly for the extracting spawning pool.
And Showtime, being a safe and sound player, already with the probe scout out on the map, but he's not going to find Bly first. And might be a bit difficult for Bly also, because we got cross positions, and I feel like the way that these games are played out, that's going to favor Showtime heavily.
So Showtime's going to put the Nexus down. From this, the gateway is going to follow. Does he need to sacrifice this position? Does he need to have, what do you do as a perfect defense? What is the perfect defense?
It's a good question. I wish I was more experienced with these types of openings.
Okay.
I have been using the one-base speedling expand versus Protoss quite a bit. Sometimes it's succeeded, but in cross-position Seras, I'm not sure how it will play out exactly. It really depends on how much the links can get done.
Well, Showtime's going to go in, and he's going to see exactly what's up. He sees Zergling speed on the way, sees six Zerglings, and now we're going to see the reaction from him, and he cancels the Nexus immediately.
All right, yeah, that's a pretty decent way to do things, I believe. He can just expand from here and keep going at his own pace.
How much does Bly invest into this, though? Does he keep building Zerglings? Does he try to save up for an expansion immediately, or...?
If he stops investing into the Zerglings right now, keeps returns to droning and taking a third base, etc., then it's not so bad. He's made 7 army supply, like how many links? 10 maybe? It's a big investment, and Showtime is far ahead in workers, but also at some point, Showtime will have to secure his natural base. And at that time, Bly might have been able to make a lot of drones on his bases again, so things can equalize. But getting the scout off, I think Showtime is in a decent spot, but we'll have to see how it plays out, because honestly, I'm just not sure. Mothership Core on the way, Adept as well. Adept, one of the best units in this situation. And Mothership Core going to help with the pylon overcharge also.
Yep. They're able to pop out with energy instantly. Kind of reminds me of the good old High Templar back in the day.
Yep, and this Adept is very important because without it, the Zerglings would be able to actually work on the gates while Mothership Core also just fending them off. But the Adept provides a way for the Protoss player to actually fend off the Zerglings without expending Mothership Core energy. So I like that Showtime is making more and more Adepts, and I think they're more versatile than the Zealots are. Also.
I can't help but feel that as a Protoss in this position, what happens if Bly never stopped building Lings and outside this, around this area, there was another 20, 30 Lings ready to pounce? And
it's
you don't
very
know
scary.
That. You, do you try to, you know, anticipate him having gone for 3 bases off this? Do you expect him to build a lot of Lings?
You don't know, and that's why Showtime is getting the Oracle, and it's also why the Stargate, excuse me, but it's going to be an Oracle, I'm pretty sure. It's a very common follow-up, but it's also why, look at this, he's crawling towards the location of the natural, and this is what you want to do, because the pylon is an investment, sure, but it's only a minor investment. I'm not exactly a big fan of that Adept blink there, because as you said earlier, there could have been 40 links waiting, and then Showtime might have been in a bit of trouble. But he's taking a chance right now. He sees these Zerglings and he realizes, yeah, there's a very high chance that Bly is transitioning right now. So he's making the right call for the situation for this game, having a great read on Bly. Bly actually making more Zerglings now.
10 more Zerglings with 3 Adepts on the other side of the map and an Oracle.
And this is the type of pressure that Showtime does all the time. It's forcing Zerglings out of Bly. I'm pretty sure Showtime, these Adepts, they're just going to go home. This is what Showtime does. He likes fake pressure. So no real investment at all, just moving out like this. He did it in a safe manner with the Mothership Core at home. And forced so many Zerglings out of Bly. It's amazing.
Is it amazing or does it boil your blood as a Zerg player?
No. I enjoy watching quality play from all the races.
There you go. Snoot respects all races. Asgard.
Very nice scout here from Bly. Gonna see the Oracle, but it's probably gonna be a bit too late. I believe the Oracle is already on the way, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes, it's at the south side. It is gone. It is
there. We go
in flight mode.
And this is a very, very common response, by the way. I tried to use a little bit of one base speedling expand in practice at, in China. And every time I would cancel the nexus of the opponent, I would always have an Oracle fly towards me. So Bly should be prepared for this.
Oh, well, he's not really, is he? He's got no spores down at all. And the Oracle's going to go into the third base, finds himself a drone or two or three.
Oof. Very painful. Some nice saves there. Dropping the spores, that's going to help at least a little bit, but still very expensive for Bly.
And behind this, the Twilight Council has been made by Showtime. And posturing a little bit aggressively on the side of this ramp here is going to move down, and looks like he wants to secure his third base as an Overseer, which then naturally reveals Layer Tech for Showtime. Obviously needing the Layer to get the
Nice
overseer.
Overcharge also.
He doesn't get it, though.
Overlord Speed, saving that Overseer.
And the Hydralis Den is down.
I have to say, Bly is recovering quite well, like everything considered, that he was forced into making additional Zerglings as well.
Yep.
But there's no Spore here, so this is dealing massive damage. This Oracle is probably at 10 kills or something.
Yeah, it had 3 before, it's at 5 additional, so it's a total of 8.
Gets away also, 8 kills on this Oracle.
And more to come probably when the shields regenerate again.
Just
and the Lurker Den and Spire, both put down.
I think that's cool. It's one of the better compositions. You can use the Lurkers defensively, and then you can use the Mutas. And Xeris is a very big map, so it makes sense to play Mutas. They're very fast, and you can secure a lot of bases on this map. You can get that heavy gas count going. And when you go Lurker and Muta at the same time, both of those units are extremely gas heavy. So I think Bly very soon is going to double expand. Here's the fourth on the way. That's the first expansion. I would not be surprised to see a fifth base, even if it's a little bit risky, because Showtime, at any given moment right now, he's moving out right now, actually.
Yeah,
and attack is still on the way.
He sees the double tech choice, and very similar to how he's done previously in this series, has decided, all right, well, if you're going to do that, you probably don't have that many units, so let's see what I can do. He pokes forward onto the edge of creep.
And Bly's doing a very good job, though, of massing the units right now, and he sees the army up close here. I think this Roaches should be morphed into Ravagers just for the extra firepower, just for those corrosive bile shots. But it seems like he will just engage head-on.
And one force will put down here. Showtime looking to trade off as good as he can, as effectively as he can, but there seems to be a little bit too many units.
Oh, that's so conservative from Showtime. I think he could have pressed on a little bit further, but he seems to be happy doing that and going into double robotics. And I don't think that's the way he wants to play against someone who's going Spire. But there's not that many gases on the way just yet, but I'm a little bit concerned for Showtime now with the Spire. Was it actually cancelled at some point?
No, surely not.
Did he just make a second Spire? I'm a bit confused right now. Either way.
It was the other one was on the natural, so I don't know if it's... He cancelled it.
That's weird, yeah.
He cancelled it.
Seems like it.
Is that just
I was sure I saw Spire in production, but
you're right. He definitely did. So well, I guess he cancelled it to make sure he could have as many units out as possible.
Yeah, the Spire is a very expensive building after all. It's 200, 200, and if you cancel it, you get 150, 150 back. It's a very expensive building, for sure.
All right, well...
Maybe a bit less. I'm probably mistaken there. You get some resources back, all right. let's bring up the approximates.
Well, the two lurkers.
Oh, that's very cute, but this Adept is going to see him, most likely.
Yes, he does.
Still has to deal with it, though, eventually.
Showtime's found himself the fifth base of Zerg, and is going to be able to force a cancel here. Always easily retreat from this position, and the Mothership Core is just trailing a little bit behind it.
Not the biggest of deals, though, fortunately for Bly. He's still on the drone count. That does not require a fifth base, so he has also yet to take the gases on his fourth, only doing it just now. I think this is more of a mistake than anything else, but losing this fifth base is no big deal, and Showtime is just here to cause a little bit more trouble once again, but this is not going to accomplish much, I believe. Tries to get one of the extractors, has to expend energy, and Showtime is just going to back off like he usually does with this fake pressure and transitional pressure, soft poking, whatever you want to call it.
So at this time, Showtime's game plan, poke a little bit, build up this fourth, establish it, get a good army, a good amount of adepts. What is Bly's plan? What can you look at it being at this point? 10 Hydra's been added into his army. Maybe drops here is going to happen very shortly.
It feels like both these players have a very similar approach to this map right now. It feels like both players just want to be primarily defensive, take more bases, get the economy going, like you said, get the army going. And look at all the technology that Bly is investing into, even getting a few overlord drops to harass here. But this is primarily a defensive stance from Bly. He's not moving out, he's only staying back except for these small harassment moves. So they're both playing very similarly right here, and I'm not sure if they're going to switch things up eventually. Maybe if Bly gets to that fifth base, gets it up and running, maybe he will change the way that he... acts in this game, so to speak, but I'm not sure.
Well, I guess you're going to see what you wanted to was the clash of control with the two larger armies, which you've already said that you'd be favoring Showtime in that. Hopefully Bly can do well in it. It's going to be very difficult, though. We know how good Showtime is, but both players looking for forms of harassment. We have the War Prism going into the main base, or at least attempting to. Two Lurker drops have not gone anywhere at this moment. We're going to have...
Oh, and Bly is completely off position now. He moved out with this pressure going towards Showtime's base. I think he might actually be trying for an attack here, but he's struggling with the Warp Prism in the main now, and this is quite bad for Bly.
Spy has been targeted, may get killed off before the upgrade completes.
And he didn't make any mutas, even losing the flyer attack upgrade.
And an attack at the same time from Bly onto the fourth base, and there's a couple of disruptors around. I remember just seeing them, so he has to be very careful and be watching his army at all times.
Yeah, this is so risky for Bly. Showtime was using two robotics at a time, and Lurker drops in the main, not going to accomplish anything because Showtime...
he's going to lose the old Overlord, and he's two disruptors. This is a fantastic defense, and this is looking terrible for Bly. He's getting absolutely cleaned up. There's two Lurkers that could deal damage. I'm not sure if there's no...
there's no Observer here, so this Lurker's actually dealing damage. Look at the supply. These Lurkers are putting in so much work right now.
And 15 workers have been killed.
Disruptor's
going to
deal with them, though. Only taking out one Lurker, so it could still be a little...
The whole main base is gone as well!
I know, losing the technology, but Bly did start another Spire. So, we didn't lose too much technology here on the Zerg side of things. It's still fine. This game is going to stabilize, at least for a little bit. Neither player has the army. to actually interact with each other right now. Everyone's just staying at home, trying to figure out what just happened, and where to take it from here. Well, what does Showtime do? Dark Shrine.
Yeah, Dark Shrine's finished up, and there's not that much detection
and
around.
There's still no spore, and he sees it. Bly has to get some spores down, and I feel like he can afford it. There's one in the front, and it should have been in the middle of the middle line, but I just take it down.
All right, and Adept tickling this fifth base once again.
Oh, that's so many disruptors. The double robo, they're working overtime right now.
And now Immortal's been added in to buffer up this army too.
So how does one deal with this type of robotics play, I wonder? Those units really pack a punch against everything on the ground, so maybe going into some sort of Sky Sword play would be the solution for Bly. I'm not sure how to deal with this.
Well, the Templar Archives is coming in. We're starting to see Showtime craft up the perfect Protoss army, which is going to be very, very difficult to deal with, especially in adding Spawn to the mix.
But considering everything that happened in this game, I have to say also that Wise creep spread is looking quite healthy. He's been under so much pressure, but still has a very healthy defensive creep spread. Still working on that, getting it across the map.
Two lurkers headed towards the furthest expansion. See if they can get some drone kills. Two DTs also, kind of exploiting these weaker flanks that Bly has.
No units here. These lurkers, Showtime's reaction time though is impeccable there. Not losing a single probe, and these lurkers might just be forfeit unless... we'll see how clean of a trade Showtime can take here. Well, and the choice, of course, Disruptor, they take the best trades against lurkers. You don't actually killing one of his own pylons there.
Zerglings into this new base too.
But this harassment, it looks very nice, but Bly, he's losing more than he's gaining, I feel. Killing 5 probes, that's nice and all. He's also losing a lot of circles for it. 6 probes, that's something, but it's not enough, I believe.
He switched over to Mutalist now as well, Snood. 7 are on the way.
I like that a lot, but it can also prompt an attack from Showtime, and Bly has to make sure that he does not overcommit to Mutas. And the Stargate even made 2 Phoenixes. Those are real, right?
Yes, they're real.
So there's always the option to make more. It's kind of strange to only have 2 Phoenixes like that, but here's the big attack from Showtime. And even if Bly has lurkers, Showtime has the disruptors that can work away at those lurkers over time. This is a very, very scary attack.
And he's got Blink, he's got +2, he's got quite a lot of Stalkers, he can always add on more, he's going to be underneath the Guardian Shield. Struggling to find if, you know, these Mutalists are going to work head-on at this point. He's given up this position.
Completely reasonable choice at this stage of the game. And Showtime once more, just taking things easy. I'm not sure if he wants to commit into this. And the next follow-up here will be the Ultralisk Cavern. We haven't really seen Ultras succeed all that much this tournament, especially against someone who's playing very robotics-heavy styles. It's no problem for Showtime to chrono boost out 2 Immortals at a time. There's already 2 Immortals in the field and a couple of Archons as well. I don't think the Ultras are going to accomplish much here. It's more important for Bly to perhaps build a lot of static defenses, make lurkers and get those Mutas out to truly counterattack and force Showtime into something far more uncomfortable. Something like Sky Protoss with the Phoenixes and then Bly can add in Vipers. Just change the tech up on this game.
I don't think that the Mutalists have been spotted yet, to be honest, Snoot.
Couple of lurkers in production though. Is this defense going to be enough?
Well, 2 Disruptor Balls trying to do some damage. They don't really get that much done. The second wave gets a lurker at the front.
There's so many Disruptors and Showtime is just firing and firing and firing.
Oh, he actually blows up an Archon in front of his army there by mistake. Fungal Growth locks down a lot of these units and he is going to hold off for now. The Mutalist though, I really don't think he's seen them at all and they're about to go on the other side of the map to cause a havoc.
Here we go, here come the Mutas and Showtime is caught completely off guard here. How is he going to respond here? What's his solution to these Mutas?
Well, he starts Phoenixes. And gonna be obviously warping
there's only one Stargate and 12 Mutas in production. Bly is going ham. He sees that there's no Phoenix army here, so he just keeps going. Showtime is in so much trouble and he's forced into an attack here.
Is there enough to actually stop Mutalists in this game?
I don't think so. So much gas went into the Disruptors and there are some Archons, a couple of Stalkers, but Bly doesn't even bother fighting the army. He knows that he has lurkers and he's able to force Showtime into a really bad spot just by ravaging his base.
We need to text David Kim right now. We need a hotfix. We need Disruptors to shoot up. Then the game is okay here for Showtime. But right now, it's a problem. 37 Mutalisks against, as you can see, a couple of Archons, 12 Stalkers, and 2 Phoenix. That is not enough.
And this is ruins of Sera's cross positions. Like, surely Showtime must have seen this coming. It's such a typical Zerg thing to do. Like, we've seen it on Deadwing. We saw it on Alter Seam, Stronghold, in Heart of the Swarm, all these big maps. This is Zerg's thing to do. They always go for the silly Muta switch. When you have the Lurkers as well, you can do this and still be safe. But oh my god!
No.
The Archons just obliterated everything.
No, 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 no. That's his tournament right there. Snoot.
No. Unreal.
Snoot. He's just lost 25 Mutalists to two Archons. That's it. That's his tournament.
The
just
pain.
There.
I can only imagine the pain that Bly is feeling right now. He had this. Was in such a favorable spot.
Now there's plus three Stalkers all around. There's still the Guardian Shield. There's an Archon in this mix as well. He's got to be careful against all the defensive Lurkers. It's not lost fully yet. And here we go. The Mutalists go in, but they can't attack into that. They snipe the Mothership Core from the back. Guardian Shield gets activated. He's trying to take it down. He's going towards the Stalkers now, slowly trying to micro back. Does he have enough?
I'm speechless, Sean. That was crazy, crazy. Those few Archons just dealt
so much damage. Neither of them are properly mining in this game.
And those Mutas, they would have been able to take out the Archons, but they were not magic boxed. They were stacked on top of each other and took the full splash damage from the Archons with those weapon upgrades, with that bonus damage to biological.
Snoot, I've seen some mistakes in my time. I've seen some mistakes. I think one of the big ones was Widow Mines versus Mutalist, maybe Revival. I think that springs to mind.
Yeah, this is definitely
huge.
At the same level.
This is huge. I can't believe how fast this game just turned around. Archons chasing
Archons.
Stalkers defending the mineral line.
I wonder how many kills those two Archons have. They had a great time down there. Man, unbelievable, unbelievable. And it should be expected as well that Showtime, in a scrappy situation like this, has some gas left over, has the Templar Archives, he can't produce anything, the Stargate is shut down. What do you make? You make Archons, it's one of the few choices that you have. You can make it from the Dark Shrine, you can make it from the Templar Archives. And when you attack the Protoss head-on, you kind of have to expect it to be some Archons there. But just one moment of attention that was not there from Bly, that's just how brutal StarCraft can be when you're competing at this level. It's horrible.
It was the start of a comeback. It was a game that was in the bag, soon to say, pretty much. The game was almost won. He just had to control the flock that he had. And just like that, Showtime back up to 160 supply to 50. And Bly is feeling the heat right now. This was almost a won game. And we have not seen something like this in a very long time in StarCraft. And unfortunately, Bly is the victim today. And he's trying to gather as much as he can back up, but it's a complete turnaround.
The rest of this game is just a painful formality as Showtime moves his army confidently towards Bly's bases, clearing out the Zerg army just like he would be clearing it out in the Legacy of the Void campaign, tiny bit at a time, blinking here and there with the massive army, the scary Protoss Death Ball, cleaning up the Zerg army little by little. Couple of Lurkers trying to deal damage to Showtime, but it's not going to be enough because look at this, just blinking into the Lurkers. Showtime doesn't care at this point. He knows how far ahead he is.
A blink forward just is going to take out the last few units in a pretty much one game.
And Showtime
flipped around 3-0.
Looking unstoppable, he knows. He knows how many units those Archons killed. But overall, Showtime with the diversity, he's looking like one of the strongest PvC players in Legacy of the Void so far.
I can't believe that there. That is unbelievable. Can't even begin. I actually can't even begin to imagine what would be going through Bly's mind right now in
sadness.
Such an important
terrible,
game.
Terrible sadness.
I mean, we saw how much it meant to him playing in this tournament, how well he was doing. He started to, you know, turn around and get some momentum back. And then just like that, it's all ripped away. Joined on the desk again by DeMuslim and Nate. You guys watched that just like we did. Wow.
Ouch. Ouch.
I had the opportunity to not just watch that happen, but I watched Bly
no.
as it happened.
What did he do?
He was just bouncing in his chair, like very, very mad at himself, I think. And after a while, he just slunk down in his chair all the way and was still on playing. But
that's how it feels.
I didn't know whether to laugh or to cry. Like, I really didn't know what to do.
Just like... I mean, we all experience it the same way, right? It's like, okay, everything's happening, boom, bang. Then you just, like, glance over, and the two Archons shred every single. It's like when, it's like the Zerg player's like, oh, I can just go in. You know, there's like only tanks or something, like the two Thors, boom, like, all dead. It's like,
he was on his way to a magnificent comeback as well. And like, Showtime was actually handling the Lurker harass really well. He had Phoenix in the right places, picking up every Lurker squad, it seemed. Yep. And then the Mutas, yeah, he had 200 supply against like, what, the 150 or so of Showtime. Looked like it was in the bag, and then Flo just managed to zoom in just at the right time as they all just popped in the air. It was like chicken feathers just flying absolutely everywhere.
Couldn't believe it.
That was brutal, man. That has to hurt. And Showtime showing again, like, I mean, even if he doesn't get the miracle crush on all those Mutas, he's still in a great place in this matchup, you know, even if he was to win, you know, 3-1 or to drop that map, but still really impressive play out of him. And the disruptor control, he had a lot of disruptors really showing, because I remember in the beta when a lot of people were like, what do we really do against Lurkers? And then as the disruptor got more tuned, people were realizing like, this is actually a pretty good way to do it. I thought his disruptor control was really good. I loved seeing it. Obviously it's a bit tricky to hit those Lurkers, but you know, also kudos to the Lurker harass. We're gonna hear from Showtime now as once again, he stays alive here at the Rocket Legacy of the Void Championship. Let's pass it over to Sue.
Thank you very much, Nathanius. Showtime, please tell me you have medals ready for those Archons.
Yeah, I guess so. Like, I was watching my army across the map. Then I switched back to my fourth base, I think. And I suddenly saw like all the Mutas die. So yeah, that was really a good moment.
Was it like, okay, I know as a professional player, there's probably a lot of moments in your career that were particularly satisfying. This must rank up there.
Oh yeah, definitely. Like, I think I was in control of the game, and then suddenly I saw the maybe like 20 Mutas in my base, and I didn't have a whole lot of anti-air. So yeah, I was really happy my Archons managed to kill all of them.
Now, let's just talk about your PVZ. I mean, it's just been astounding because throughout this tournament, you've shown such a diverse array of strategies. And in preparing for Legacy of the Void, has that been something you're specifically focusing on? Because some players choose to rather hone in on one or two, but it really seems like you just came with a plethora of strategies.
I wasn't really focusing on practicing a ton of different strategies, but in PVC, I was losing a lot. So I kept trying new stuff. So I have like all these builds I tried that I can bring here now.
Wait, so but you said you kept losing, so you kept trying new stuff. And so, I mean, if you're losing trying this stuff and therefore trying new stuff, but it's working. So, I mean, how does that work?
I don't know really. Like, on ladder, I'm just losing a lot of PVC. So I just keep trying new stuff and apparently it works.
All right, well, Showtime, we have a gift for you. You defeated two Zerg, you defeated a Laser, and you just defeated Bly, and our gift to you is that you play another Zerg. Yeah, it's amazing. You're going to be playing either Firecake or Nurchio, and these two have been doing really, really well at this tournament, so I'm sure you're really happy about that. So, I mean, what are your thoughts?
Yeah, another Zerg, so I have to try my best. I guess it's working fine so far, so we'll see.
And in terms of Firecake and Nurchio specifically speaking, I'm sure you've played against both of them many a times on ladder and things like that. So do you have a particular player that you'd either prefer or, I don't know, not want to play against?
It's kind of hard to say. Like, against Nurchio, I've been losing a lot on ladder. So I think he's a bit scary. But I kind of know his style, so maybe I can make something work. And against Firecake, I think he has been playing on a barcode on ladder. And I don't know which one. So I don't really know how good he really is. In the qualifier for this tournament, I actually beat him 2-0. But this was like maybe 1 or 2 months ago now. So yeah, I'm not quite sure how good he is.
All right then. Well, thank you very much, Showtime, for the amazing series. I'm looking forward to your series. Indeed, of course, for the next match we have coming up, it will be our first winner's match. It'll be Parting versus Solar. One of these Koreans will be going down to the lower bracket to face TUI. We'll find out soon enough who it is after this break.